Dear Bethesda, what the heck is going on with the rest of the world? Oh crap, I almost forgot to say the thing. Hi, it's me, Austin. You thought I was done with you, didn't you? But nope, I got all sorts of crap rattling inside of my head to overanalyze with the powers of science. And today I'm finally going to tackle the biggest question that's always bugged me, the plague on my brain for years that I've wondered about. What is going on with the rest of the world outside of the United States in the Fallout games? We have a lot to tackle today, from extensive, nerdy, nitty-gritty lore, social sciences, global trade numbers, ecology, meteorology, and God knows how much else. So let's get down to business to defeat the Todd. Okay, that was terrible, but I have bronchitis right now and I regret nothing! Alright, so my show is called The Science, so let's do some legit science using the scientific method! Step one is ask a question, and we did that. What the hell is going on in the rest of the world? Step two is do some background research, which we'll get to in a second. We're gonna skip to step number three, the most fun part! Construct a hypothesis. I think given all we know about Fallout lore, from the size of the nukes, the strike zones of various countries, and all the data given to us in the game, that most of the world, specifically countries in Africa, South America, and Switzerland specifically, are thriving as futuristic utopias while the rest of the world looks like, well, like this. But before we can go over why this is, well, I'm gonna step aside real quick and flex my shoddy cast muscles and let an old friend of mine carry us a bit.
Tamriel.
In the back when times, before the bombs dropped, America was, well, it was different.
Starvation was rampant. Cars sat in front of houses, undriven. People were hiding in their homes, encouraged by the United States government to avoid ice cream socials because of a virulent disease known as the New Plague that was ravaging the world. And in April 1952, the resource wars began. As oil fields across the world ran dry, nation fought against nation over the last drops of fossil fuel that they needed to keep the exponentially increasing demands for energy met. Europe went to war with the Middle East over rising oil prices, and less than 3 months after the resource wars began, the United Nations crumbled. The resource wars dragged on for generations, erupting in battlefields and proxy wars across the entire globe. For 25 years, the biggest superpowers with the biggest energy demands burned away the last vestiges of the very resources they were fighting over until there was nothing left. In the end, it was between the United States and the Chinese Red State. America had annexed Mexico and Canada to complete supply lines, dominating, finally and officially, the entirety of the continent. In 2066, Westech unveiled the first crude microfusion cell, a technology that would revolutionize the world and alleviate energy demands everywhere by using hydrogen, the most abundant element in the entire universe, as a source of fuel. Unfortunately, it was too little too late. In spite of their best efforts, microfusion technology just couldn't hit the mainstream market fast enough to stop the inevitable. 13 years later, on October 23rd, 2077, at 9:47 in the morning Eastern Time, nuclear fire erupted across the United States. In 2 hours, as dictated by the mutually assured destruction military doctrine, every nuclear-capable nation on Earth launched their arsenals on their enemies. In 0.1% of the total time humanity has been on Earth,
irrevocably, humanity was changed forever. And this is now the world we live in.
The safe word is Asimov.
Man, I miss that guy. Anyway, this is most of the lore that you'll need, but here's some extra. The bombs used primarily in the Great War, the event that caused the world of Fallout, were relatively small. Relatively. According to the Fallout 1 manual, which, like, if you're an aspiring lore or science junkie, I highly recommend because this thing is deeply researched. It's bananas. Anyway, according to the manual, most huge Tsar Bomba-style bombs had been retired because smaller bombs could actually potentially be more destructive because they don't launch radioactive fallout nearly as high into the air, but instead pepper it down in the surrounding area where it can cause lasting, irreparable harm to the local residents and environment. In a science video that I did approximately 100 years ago, I calculated that it would take approximately 66,676 of these weapons to turn America, including Mexico and Canada, China, Russia, Europe, and the Middle East into the irradiated, useless wastes that we see today, which is a lot of nukes. When fission bombs, bombs that are created by forcing fissile material like uranium to undergo a nuclear chain reaction where the atomic bits flying off piece by piece trigger other atoms to fling other bits off, which yada yada yada, which releases a McButt ton of energy in the form of heat and gamma rays, which are high energy photons. They blast apart as this energy expands, and unfortunately, most of the fissile material doesn't actually get to react. Instead, these highly radioactive metals vaporize and get spread out in a hot dust cloud. This is what radioactive fallout is. It literally, you know, falls out of the sky. Most of the radioactive material is carried up into the hot clouds of gas that rise from ground zero, known as a mushroom cloud because, well, look at it. Anyway, in really high energy detonations that are measured in megatons, these clouds can rise really high into the air, into the troposphere, where most of the radioactive material will hang out for, well, a pretty long time. The negative is that this will block sunlight across the globe as the debris spreads across the Earth, which in the case of one detonation is not that huge of a deal. But in the event of something like fallout, oh, God, this would create a nuclear winter that could last for God knows how long. Thankfully, though, in the day and age of Fallout's Great War, the nukes were much smaller, since there's diminishing returns on the destructive blast radius with higher yields, which requires exponentially more uranium to create exponentially diminishing blast zones with an exponentially increasing cost to construct them. And at 750 kilotons, most nuclear debris won't reach the troposphere for going a nuclear-induced death cloud of winter. This also has the added bonus of making the bombs infinitely more deadly, since all that dangerous radioactive metal will rain down on anybody unfortunate enough to have survived the initial blast, seeping into the dirt, plants, and working its way up the food chain into animals and humans, where it will cause all sorts of cancers, just all of them. All the cancers. Why am I telling you all of this? Why go over the, well, okay, not really the nitty-gritty, because I really wanted to get into the detailed physics of mushroom clouds, but there's no time! Anyway, why focus on the bomb sizes so much? Because, well, it turns out that this smaller yield of bomb completely changes the global impact of a massive-scale nuclear war. For one thing, it narrows the impact of radioactive materials to the local areas, mainly, in this case, the United States, Europe, Russia, and China.
China!
And in order to understand why this is important in figuring out how the other countries in the world are faring, we gotta talk about the military doctrine that makes this all possible. Mutually assured destruction. Mutually assured destruction, shortened to MAD, as in you'd have to be out of your freaking mind to put this theory to the test, is a military doctrine that became gospel during the Cold War. With the invention of nuclear weaponry and the proof that they were utterly devastating during Hiroshima and Nagasaki, owners of these demonstrably destructive weapons capable of upending entire regions silently agreed to a basic idea. I won't nuke you if you do not nuke me. If anybody broke this agreement, all hell would break loose, and, well, everyone would die. But the most important thing to keep in mind is that while the gun is pointed at everyone's head, it's only pointed at the heads of those who are armed. It's a Mexican standoff where everyone with a gun is at risk. But if you don't have a gun, you're not even playing the same game. So in the case of the Great War, only nuclear powers are at risk, meaning people who either have no nuclear capability, or at least not a significant enough one to be a large threat are off the table. Which means, specifically, only major countries that were fighting in the resource wars, China, Southeast Asia, Russia, Europe, the Middle East, and North America are targets. This means that countries in Africa, save for perhaps Egypt and Angola, large oil exporters, and South America, except for probably Venezuela, are not only safe from nuclear oblivion, but are probably thriving. But why would these nations thrive in a world where 80% of the world economy has been obliterated and all energy reserves are gone? One word. Nuclear. Not one word. Oh my god, I can't even count. Two words. Nuclear fusion. Nuclear fusion, and more specifically, microfusion, was on track to stop the resource wars, and by extension, the Great War, by providing the world with basically infinite energy for everything. But it couldn't spread fast enough. Hydrogen, the fuel that's easiest to fuse, also happens to be the most abundant element in the universe. With the biggest antagonists and exploiters on the planet out of the way, African and South American countries have a massive power vacuum to fill with little to no resistance and now effectively infinite energy. Now, things would be rough to start with. The United States, Netherlands, Germany, France, China, Spain, Canada, Belgium, and Italy all rank in the top 10 food exporters in the world. Whereas Burkina Faso, Cameroon, Central African Republic, Chad, Democratic Republic of Congo, Djibouti, Eritrea, and Ethiopia are all in the top 10 food importers in the world, meaning that they don't have the capacity at the moment to grow their own food sustainably for their population. Africa and South America are among the richest regions on Earth when it comes to natural resources, and while the global trade balance would totally be screwed for years, maybe even decades, having survived the nuclear holocaust with governments and social programs intact and their biggest competitors and, most importantly, exploiters out of the picture and the biggest energy advancement in history at their disposal, these countries would be blowing the hell up, metaphorically. Even food isn't a problem because Brazil is one of the largest food exporters in the entire world. Working together, these nations could dominate the planet. But if that's the case, why don't we see them in Fallouts 1 through 4? Why aren't they colonizing? Well, for a few reasons. One, why would they? America, China, Russia, they suck now. They're radioactive, drained of natural resources. Why bother? Screw them, let them rot. Two, maybe they do a little bit. The Rangers in Fallout New Vegas are mentioned as having fought in Baja against a strong military as the new California Republic attempts to spread south. They could easily be coming into conflict with South American colonies and militaries. And three, maybe they're all dead. Wait, I just realized they could all actually be dead. Oh god, maybe everyone is actually doomed and I missed it all! Dang it! Alright, let's take a look at the scientific method again. Okay, can't really experiment other than dropping real nukes. I'll just cross this bit out and put overthink stuff. Wait, I thought there was something. Ah! Here it is! In models from the latest studies in the effects of nuclear war involving an exchange of only 100 World War II size nukes, many times smaller than the ones used in Fallout, and much less than my conservative estimate of 66,000, there'd be global famine and death regardless of location due to a global temperature drop of over 6 degrees Celsius on average, shortening growing seasons to just a couple of months in the hottest places on Earth, and even then they might not get enough sun to actually grow anything. But why? Why is this happening if the nukes aren't launching radioactive fallout high enough to cause nuclear winter? Because it isn't caused by the initial explosions. It's caused by the aftermath. Raging infernos. Weapons are hot enough to light concrete on fire, and the fires that would rage for months, maybe years afterwards, would dump tons, literal tons of soot and ash into the air. More specifically, hot ash would rise into the stratosphere. Up here, soot would absorb and reflect sunlight away from the Earth. To get a sense of why this is a bad thing, check out this wind model from earth.nullschool.net. This is wind patterns on the surface. Nuclear fallout would stay largely regional here, moving a bit, but not a lot. But this is wind at the stratosphere. Soot would rise up from the nations that were bombed for literal months and sweep across the entire northern hemisphere before slowly seeping into the south, blocking the sun across the entire globe in less than a year. This would last for decades, making growing food utterly impossible, and food stores would be entirely exhausted in a couple years tops. New hypothesis: these countries, the entire world, is doomed. The only countries to survive are the Americans hidden in vaults that aren't experimental vaults meant to drive them insane, anybody who hid in China and Russia, and the entirety of Switzerland, which has enough fallout shelters right now to protect their entire population. This is really it. This is it. You know what sucks the most about this? This is the best case scenario. The Fallout games are the best case scenario should mutually assured destruction be realized. What's far more likely is the complete and total extinction of every human on Earth. Great! Just wonderful. Oh, and just for fun, there's still over 14,000 nuclear warheads on Earth right now. Nowhere near the amount needed to falloutify the entire Western and Eastern civilization, but way more than enough to create global famine many times over. Just great. We're all doomed. Yay! Sincerely, Austin. Oh, hey. You subscribe to the channel. I barely have my breath anymore because, of course, I got sick after moving to a new city over several hundred miles, and my chest is barely working. So, let's get down to business to subscribe to us.